God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin can now be heard on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday mornings at 7 a.m. Central, 8 Eastern, and on Sunday mornings at his regular time, 6 Central, 7 Eastern. Join with him and let's turn our country back to God. It only takes a spark to start a forest fire. Let's get on fire for the Lord. Right here on K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network. K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we are expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level, or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at sales@k98fm.com.
Come and listen in to a radio station where the mighty hosts of heaven sing. Turn your radio on.
Turn your radio on.
Turn your radio on.
Turn your radio on.
If you want to hear the songs of Zion coming from the land of endless spring,
get in touch with God.
Turn your radio on. Turn your radio on.
Turn your radio on.
And listen to the music in the air.
Turn your radio on.
Turn your radio on. Heaven's
glory
listening to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin. Richard will guide you through the Bible and help you find God's purpose for your life.
Welcome this morning to God's Pure Word of Faith. I'm Richard Hardin. I'll be here with you now for the next couple of hours if you'll stick around with me. I want to start out as I normally do in thanking the Lord for this opportunity and thanking the management at K98Talk.com for having this great opportunity to share God's Word with you today. Now, in the previous messages, I've covered the Trinity and Jesus Part 1. Today, I'll be covering some more information about Jesus and the Trinity, too. These scriptures, you know, when sharing a subject like this, you can't get just one scripture that has one topic in it and share those. Some scriptures have to be used, you know, in one subject area and use the same scripture again in the next subject area. So you wind up using some of the same scriptures. So I will today be naturally sharing some more of the same scriptures, but looking at a different aspect of it maybe as we go through the scripture. But I'm going to be covering more about Trinity and Jesus because there's so many things being taught in error, and there's so many things being left out that are very important and critical that we know and understand if we're going to, you know, study about God and Well, like in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 2 says, "Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord." So it's very important that we study these different aspects of the Lord and characteristics and things that will help us in our image of God, and also help us to be able to, you know, just have more confidence and faith and trust in Him because of the way He is and the things that Jesus has already done for us and everything. Before I get started on the message, I want to share with you about my website, because it has a lot of information that in books and videos and blogs that will be helpful to you to be able to look at and sit down and kind of read at your own pace and everything, and maybe back up and hear it again or something like that. But right now I want to share with you about my website.
Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books.
And welcome back. And today I'm going to be sharing more about Jesus. And a couple of reasons is, you know, there's things we need to be careful. Jesus says one place in the Gospels when he was here, he said, we're going to have to answer for every idle word we speak. Now, certainly as Christians, and in 2 Corinthians 5:20, it says we're ambassadors for Christ. We need to be seeking to share God's pure word when we're sharing with others. And so it behooves us, you know, to do what we can to try to be the best representative, the best ambassador that we can be, because ambassadors do not have the authority to change any of the word of the master that gives them, or whoever it is that they're being an ambassador for. Like an ambassador for our president has no authority to change any message that the president gives him. Well, that's the way it is with us. We're ambassadors for Christ. Christ, the living, pure Word of God, the wisdom of God. It says in 1 Corinthians 1:24, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. See, the wisdom, the perfect Word of God is Christ. And we don't have that authority to change it. In fact, in Proverbs chapter 30, verse 5 and 6, it says, every word of God is pure. See, Christ is pure. Every word of God is pure. A shield them put their trust in Him. Add thou not to it, lest He reprove thee, and thou be found a liar. See, so when we change His word, the way we're reproved and found a liar is that He won't back it up. We'll say, well, God told me this, and then it doesn't happen, or, you know, something like this. Well, see, God will not back up the word that we share if we've changed His word, because then it's ours. But as long as it's His pure word, He will back it up. And you say, well, you're just kind of playing with words and everything. Yes, but Jesus says we're going to answer for every idle word that we speak. For an example, so many of us have heard just recently in the last few days, you know, during the resurrection period of, you know, celebration and everything, that Christ died for our sins. No, He didn't. Jesus died for our sins. When Jesus was here on earth, and until He was resurrected to become part of the fullness of Godhead bodily, Jesus and Christ were different. Jesus was a man Jesus here on earth. Christ was the Father or the Spirit of God in Him. See, and there's a big difference there. And the Spirit of Christ left His heart on the cross when He, right before He cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? See, the man Jesus sinned was left hanging on the cross and without the Spirit of Christ in his heart anymore. Now, separation of the heart from God is sin. So that's when He took on the sins of the world. The man Jesus did, see, He took on the sins of the world when Christ left His heart and left Him hanging alone on the cross with our sins, the separation of His heart from God, from His heart and His Father. Yeah, and that's when he performed the function like of our scapegoat, taking our sins from us, you know, like that, and suffering those sins on the cross. See, so it during the time that Jesus was here on earth, he and Christ were different. He was a man. Christ, the living Word, was in him, in his heart, to the fullness. Now see, Christ is in our heart. I'm a man. Christ is in my heart, but not to the fullest. Because see, we have to grow to be more like Jesus, to allow more of God's living Word to come into us. And it says that he came in the fullness of the measure of the Spirit of God in him. We grow in measures as we allow more of his Word to come into us now. So it's very important when we say these things. And in saying that Jesus left his throne and came to die for us, no, he didn't. Jesus was born the man with Christ in him, and he came in his ministry at age 33. When he started, it says he came in the fullness of the Spirit of grace and truth. Truth being God's Word. So he was full of the Spirit of grace, God's love, and the Word, this truth. Now, so we need to, be more careful like that in the way we say things, because it gets so confusing. And others have taught that Jesus, when he died on the cross, immediately or soon after went to hell and fought the devil and did things like this and came out of hell, victorious with the keys to the kingdom, victory over the devil. No, he didn't. The devil's never been in hell. He's never going to be in hell. He's going to be cast into the lake of fire. Revelations chapter 20 and verse 10, when it starts talking about the lake of fire, right before that, it says that he is the devil and his angels are cast into the lake of fire. Then mentioned and talks about the white throne judgment, and then it says hell and everything in it will be cast into the lake of fire. See, the devil's not in hell today. He's here on earth deceiving people and doing his work, trying to keep people from turning to the Lord and trying to separate us, cause us to be confused about God's Word and cause us to, fail to enter into that relation with God that God wants us to have. And we can only please God by faith. Hebrews 11:6, but without faith it's impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So if he can plant any doubt in people's minds to keep them from diligently seeking God, if you don't believe a promise, if you don't believe something in God's Word necessarily, and it's so good that, like John 15:7, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask what you will and it shall be done to you. That is such a fantastic promise if we're just receiving his words into our heart and living according to them. We'd get all our prayers answered. Jesus did. He got all of his prayers answered and everything. But if the devil can just cause us to have that little bit of doubt in us, like it says in the book of James, we must ask in faith. But if we have that little bit of doubt, we won't diligently seek after something if we really don't believe that it's going to do us any good. But then also, it says, he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. And without faith, it's impossible to please God. So if he can cause us in any way to not have faith in God, or to diligently seek his word and everything like that, then we cannot have the relationship with God that God wants us to have. So that's the devil's job and work here on earth, is to try to keep us separated in our heart, or keep us separated to where we are not fulfilling God's purpose for us here on earth. And like it says also in 2 Timothy 1:9, that God saved us and called us to a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, created in Christ Jesus before the world began. So you have a special holy calling here on earth from God in your life. And if the devil can keep you from seeking it, see, you'll never find it, because we won't just stumble into it. We have to set ourselves to seek the Lord. And it's evil if we don't. Now, so that, the devil is here working on earth trying to deceive people. And that's where Jesus fought the devil. because the devil had him arrested illegally that night, had him tried illegally by the Sanhedrin, that is according to the laws of that day and everything of God. And so he could have argued back and fought back, but that's why he's called our lamb without blemish, because sheep don't fight back. They just kind of go. And Jesus didn't fight back either. He let his father take care of him as he was going through that. He didn't argue and fight. And then on the cross, when he got through all of that, all the suffering of, you know, the bleeding and dying on the cross from the nail-pierced hands and feet and the thorns on his head and the plucking his beard and the stripes on his back, and he got through all of that, he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He was praying for those people that had been persecuting him there and was being, you know, used in a sense. But he made it all the way to the end, dying with love in his heart for those people. So that's where he fought the devil. He didn't go to hell after he died and fought the devil and fight the devil down there. He fought him here on earth and was victorious. And then on the cross he said, it is finished. And he had finished his work. In several places in the scripture it says he suffered once in sins for us. But then, see, after that time he was resurrected, and God loved, well, he loves everybody with a perfect love. But God was so pleased with Jesus and what he did and going through all that, the perfect walk of faith and shedding his blood on the cross and everything, dying for our sins. God was so pleased with him, he exalted him not to just be our mediator, but through that, he exalted him to the fullness of the Godhead bodily and completed the Trinity with Jesus in. The exalted man, Jesus. So when we say that Jesus went to hell and fought the devil, that, you know, it's impossible. The devil's never been in hell in the first place. And that Jesus fought the devil here on earth. Now, so today then, let's see, I'm starting, I got a little off the subject there to, to get started and everything. But the Trinity concept of God, just a quick review here from what was shared in the previous message, is a spiritual relationship of the Trinity is similar to the physical relationship between, in Genesis chapters 42 to 50, Joseph, who was exalted by the Pharaoh to the second highest position in the land. He was above everybody in the land except the Pharaoh. And Joseph then carried out the Pharaoh's will by his word. So the relationship between Joseph, the Pharaoh willed, Joseph performed through his word and gave Joseph the authority, full authority over Egypt except for the Pharaoh, to perform the Pharaoh's will. Now, in the spiritual relationship of the Trinity, the Father wills, but he's, like Jesus said in Matthew 20:18, all power in heaven and earth is given to me. God the Father wills. Jesus performs the Father's will through his living word, Christ. See, when Jesus speaks that living word, Christ goes forth. Up until that time, in the Old Testament, it says that God spoke and the living word went forth. Like he said, let there be light, and the living word, Christ, then went forth. God spoke to Moses when he was growing up. And it says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 26, that Moses esteemed the reproach of Christ greater than the riches of Egypt. So he left Egypt. He left Egypt to join his own, you know, people. But it was Christ. God is, you know, supreme, and he speaks his word. But he and his word are the same. It's just he's manifesting his word in a message in our mind and heart or something that we can understand, that he's giving us some type of direction or something. But in Psalms 138:2, says God has exalted his word above all his names, because he and his word are the same. Like in John chapter 1 verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now, so God then, in the Old Testament, spoke the Word. But if you look in Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 3, it says that in the times past, that God spoke through the prophets. He spoke to the people directly. But it says now he's given Jesus the authority to speak his word. Jesus is the one now that speaks to us. So God has kind of stepped back, like the Pharaoh stepped back when Joseph was, exalted to the second highest position. Well, when Jesus was exalted to the fullness of God, God loved what he did and pleased so much what he did that Jesus is the speaker of the Trinity now. But when he speaks, his word is the word of God, because Jesus is in the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And so with the Trinity then is God the Father, Jesus, who is the upfront speaker in this day and age, and then the living word Christ, which we refer to mostly as the Holy Spirit. That any work of God in our lives is from referred to as Christ speaking. We call out to God for salvation, or we call out to Jesus for salvation. Jesus speaks his word, and then our salvation comes from him sending his word, the Spirit of Christ, into our heart. In Romans 8:9, the scripture says that if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. See, so we call out to God or Jesus for salvation. Jesus then speaks in response to an honest prayer and sends his word then into our heart. There was a difference between Jesus and Christ up until Jesus was exalted to the fullness of Godhead bodily. And that's why it's used several times in a way that the people of the Old Testament, the writers there, see, that was after Jesus was exalted to the fullness of Godhead bodily. And even the Apostle Paul didn't meet Jesus on the road to Damascus until, after he was exalted to the fullness of Godhead bodily. So from that time on, Jesus and Christ were essentially the same today. It's just a different manifestation of them. We call them part of the Trinity. But we only have one God and one Spirit. But now, I want to share with you some information here about Jesus and Christ. And remember, they are the same today. But in Jesus' life then, when he started, it says, Jesus sent his angel Gabriel to Mary to tell Mary his son's name in Luke 1:31. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son and call his name Jesus. Jesus is his name, not Jesus Christ. Now, in Matthew 1:16, the scripture states that Jacob begot Joseph, husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called Christ. He's called Christ. See, Christ was used in those days and still as the Messiah, or, the anointed one, something like that. But in Matthew chapter 16, when Peter asked Jesus, Peter answered Jesus the question of who Jesus was, he turned to the disciples and he said, who do men say that I am? And they said, different people, a prophet, a good man, the Messiah, and some of them. But he said, who do you say that I am? Okay, now, and this is when Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Christ, see, the Son of the living God. But that was not Jesus' name. Jesus then in verse 20 told his disciples, then charged he his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ. Now the disciple Andrew, speaking to his brother in John chapter 1 verse 41, says he findeth first his own brother Simon and said unto him, we have found the Messiah, which is being interpreted the Christ. Jesus says he is the Messiah in John 4:25-26. The woman said unto him, I know the Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. Jesus said to her, I am he that speaketh unto thee. Most of the common people of the day were expecting, God to send the Messiah, the Christ. as shown in John 7:26, says, "Behold, he speaketh boldly, and they say nothing unto him." Because see, he was only speaking his Father's words. He says the other place in John said, "I only speak what my Father tells me to speak. I only do what my Father tells me to do." So he did it with like more of authority than other people who had been speaking and teaching about God, because they were just teaching what they could study and find out from each other. But Jesus was teaching and speaking what he had found out from his Father. So he did speak with authority. It said, "But lo, he speaketh boldly, and they say nothing to him. Do the rulers indeed know that this is the very Christ?" And in John chapter 10, verse 24, "Then came the Jews round about him and said unto him, How long do you make us doubt? If thou be the Christ, tell us plainly." And then in John chapter 20, verse 31, it says, "These are written," that's the stories of his, you know, life and everything, the miracles he performed, stuff like that. It said, "These are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you might have life through his name." Now, but there is some confusion today, though, like I mentioned earlier, from always using the name Jesus, Jesus Christ, and Christ Jesus incorrectly at different times like that, because that the man Jesus was while he was here on earth, before he was resurrected and exalted to the fullness of Godhead bodily, and now Jesus Christ and Jesus are the same. Now, Jesus was a man, and Christ was a living word manifested in Jesus. And Christ in Jesus is the same living word of God spoken of in Hebrews 11:26 about Moses esteeming the reproach of Christ greater than all the treasures in Egypt. Now, after Jesus' resurrection, in Acts chapter 2, verse 36, the Apostle Peter says, "Therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made this same Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ." See, God had made Jesus Lord and Christ after he was crucified. So Christ didn't die on the cross. The man Jesus, died on the cross. And the Apostle Paul now always used Jesus Christ or Christ Jesus, because Paul met Jesus after Jesus had been exalted to the position or the equality with God. But Paul also knew the importance of the difference of Jesus' names and the need to be specific in what he was explaining or talking about. Listen in 1 Timothy 2:5, where the Apostle Paul says here, "For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus." So in a sense, he's saying the man Jesus, because the man Jesus is the one that God was going to exalt to become our mediator, but he exalted him through that position just to the fullness of the Godhead bodily. He was so pleased with Jesus. Therefore, after Jesus' death on the cross to become our mediator, he then was exalted to equality with God. And 1 John 2:22 states, "Who is a liar but he that denieth that Jesus is the Christ?" See, Jesus, the man Jesus, was the Christ, the Messiah that God had sent, you know, with his message, his anointing and everything. But he became the fullness of the Godhead bodily after his resurrection, and God exalted him to the fullness of that position. And again, Christ left him right before he died on the cross, when Jesus cried out in Matthew 27 and Mark 15, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" And then the Spirit of Christ, or God, left Jesus, the man, hanging on that tree to take our sins. And then in John 19:30, Jesus says, "It is finished." His work was finished. Now, and so,
we'll be right back with more of God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin right here on K98 Talk. Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books. The leader in talk radio on the Internet, right here on K98Talk.com. You're listening to K98Talk.com. The way Internet radio should be. Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books. Now back to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin.
Welcome back. And just a quick, brief summary of what I just shared about Jesus and Christ. A very short time before Jesus died on the cross, the Spirit of God, Christ, left the man Jesus. And since sin is a separation of the heart of man from God, Jesus, who never before knew any separation from his Father or sin, was left with the total sin of mankind for that short period of time while people were standing around, and some even tried to give him vinegar, and they were waiting, and some thinking to see Elijah's come and rescue him or something. But the Apostle John records that after the vinegar was offered to Jesus, Jesus said in John 19:30, "It is finished," bowed his head, and died, fulfilling the requirements for our sin debt, the perfect sacrifice, and the shedding of his blood, or the sprinkling of his blood. It says in 1 Peter chapter 1, the sprinkling of Jesus' blood, the blood, you know, out of his head, from the thorns on his head, the people plucked his beard, his 2 hands and 2 feet were pierced with the nails, and then the stripes on his back. It fulfilled the 7 sprinklings of the blood of the sacrificial animals in the Old Testament. Jesus' blood that they were sacrificing on the cross, but as he was dying on the cross, he was sprinkling or sharing his blood or giving his blood, the lifeblood, for us and our sins. And so that's what it means by the sprinkling of Jesus' blood. Now, Christ is the Holy Spirit. In the book of Acts, some people were asked, "Have you received the Holy Spirit when you believed?" A lot of times the word believed is used in the, well, just used incorrectly, because they'll say, "Are you a believer?" And then asking a question in that way, a person, you know, say, "Oh yes, I'm a believer. I believe in Jesus. I believe in God," or something like this. And quite often I've heard ministers say, "Well, we're believers, you know, and we're all going to heaven," and something. But see, just being a believer doesn't mean we're going to heaven. That's the seriousness of it. James 2:19, it says the devils believe and tremble. And the devils believe and tremble. That means there's something different about what we as Christians must do, or, you know, respond or receive, other than just believing. For an example, if you have doubt about something, you set yourself to seek the Lord. At least prayerfully, you will. A lot of people, you know, turn to alcohol, drinking, and different things, power, money, and stuff like that, to try to, you know, cover up their doubts and fears and stuff. But we set ourselves to seek the Lord, though. And as we're seeking Him, praying and fasting like this, then when He speaks to us, when God sends His living word to us, or, you know, when we recognize and know that it's, you know, Jesus or God speaking to us, well, then we come to a point intellectually that we believe it is God speaking to us, and we know it's God speaking to us. Now, I know if you're a Christian out there, there's times in your life where you know without a shadow of a doubt that God manifested some way or another to you, a message or something, and that's what we call, you know, speaking to us or something. Anyway, so what happens then, it's not the fact that we just believe that God has spoken to us, it's how we respond to what He speaks to us. Like in Hebrews 4:2, it says, the gospel preached to them did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. See, just hearing God's word, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. But just hearing and believing God's word is not salvation. That doesn't make you a Christian. You may have been sitting in church for years like I did, knowing or believing that God's word is true and everything, but that didn't make me a Christian. Just like in where it says, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. But then in Psalms 119:9, it says, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? It says, by taking heed thereto according to God's word. See, just hearing God's word is not the final step in the salvation process, because God has promised to bring everybody to a knowledge of Him. Then we have to make the choice to respond correctly. 2 Thessalonians 2:10-11 says, the Apostle Paul says that people go to hell because they reject the love of the truth. So when God brings us to that knowledge that we're a sinner, that Christ is the answer, and that we should make some type of response, we have to choose Him. We have to choose to receive His word into our heart, to faith. And that then is how we receive the love of the truth. Because, you know, His word, Jesus says in John 6:63, my words are spirit and they're life. So we receive His Spirit into our heart, we're receiving the love of His words. But if we reject, then just because we know and believe that God is real, that God is true, see, we're not receiving Him into our heart to create in us a new heart, a new life for salvation. So just the fact that you believe and you, you know, have that confidence in you that God is real, and that Jesus was God's Son, like that, that does not, just knowing that, make you a Christian. We have to make the proper response to it. And the people that was in Hebrews 4:2, where it says, and the gospel preached them did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. See, they were rejecting the love of the word, the love of the gospel. And that is so difficult to explain, because for 20-something years I was in church the same way. I knew God was real. I knew that Jesus was His Son and like this. But I had not received, in a sense, His words into my heart to create in me the new heart, the new life, to, in a sense, respond correctly. I have a friend here in town that said after preaching for several years, that one night he was inviting people to come and surrender their hearts to the Lord and ask God to forgive them their sins and, you know, turn to the Lord with all your heart. And he said a voice spoke to him and said, you've never done that. And he said it shocked him so much. He said in his heart and mind, he said, that's right, I haven't. He went around to the front of the pulpit and received Christ as his personal Lord and Savior while he, you know, had been preaching for several years. We know what to do, but see, we've got to do it, not just know what the information is. Now, the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost is used to identify which spirit the writers of the original text, which one they were referring to, like the scripture holy or the scripture unholy. Excuse me. There's only one spirit of God, as the Apostle Paul states in Ephesians 4:4-6. There's one body, one spirit, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father. Now we've seen that God the Father has given the exalted man, Jesus, equality, and Jesus rules by his spoken word, Christ. Therefore, the Holy Spirit is the overall reference to any action of Christ, the living word, moving or working in our lives on earth, because Jesus and God the Father are in heaven. The Spirit of the living word, Christ, is with us and in us. And like it says in Colossians, 1:27, Christ in us, our hope of glory. And we use a lot of names interchangeably with the Holy Spirit or in the place of the Holy Spirit, which include Christ, the living word. And, well, this is similar to the way in the Old Testament when they were talking about God as their healer. They said, God is my healer, my deliverer, my fortress. And they called him different names according to the subject they were talking about or discussing or something like that. Well, in the New Testament, the writers do the same thing. They have a lot of different names for the Holy Spirit and Jesus. Spirit of truth, spirit of life, spirit of Christ, spirit of adoption, spirit of his son, who is Christ, the spirit of Jesus, in him was Christ, the spirit of promise. And see, each time the writers would, use one of these terms like this, the spirit of truth, they were talking about God's word, because Jesus says, my words are truth in their life, Also, he said in John chapter 17, asking in his prayer, he says, sanctify them by thy word. Thy word is truth. So when they use these different expressions like that, it's not just a different aspect of God or something. It just brought to mind what area they were going to be discussing as they were writing this, because there's only one God and one Spirit. Now, Christ, then, is the work of God's Spirit in our hearts. And we refer to that as a work of grace. When he comes into our heart to create us a new heart, a new life, like that, we call it the work of grace, because when God just puts his Spirit on people, that's mercy. His Spirit on us and to us and working our lives like that. So in believing that God is real and believing that Jesus, was God's son, he died on the cross and all this, our only proper response to that is in our heart then to receive him into our heart, invite him to come in and not just know that he's real and like this. So often, using the word belief like that is it's misleading sometimes, because people indicate that just if you're a believer, then you're going to be taken care of. There's going to be a lot of believers in hell in the lake of fire because they didn't respond then according to their belief. They say something like, I want to wait till I get out of college. I want to wait till I get married. I want to wait till something. I want to get my life cleaned up. See, God doesn't want us to wait. When we come to a knowledge of him, and it says in Titus 2:11 that the grace of God that bringeth salvation appeared to all men, that is the time of salvation. The time of salvation is when you hear from God and recognize the truth of him and his love in the heart. So when the people ask, have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed? Something like this. Yes, we believe first, and then we respond and call out to Jesus for salvation, and then he sends his Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ, then, as a result of our prayer and calling out to him for salvation, he sends the Holy Spirit, or the Spirit of Christ, then, back into our hearts As it says in Ezekiel 36:26, a new heart also will I give you, a new spirit will I put within you, and I'll take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I'll give you a heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit into you. See, so just believing is not the total end result that we need for salvation. Now, we do need to believe, certainly, but it doesn't stop there. We have to respond correctly according to that belief. Now, and Jesus has been exalted to the fullness of Godhead bodily. Jesus rules the kingdom by his spoken word, Christ. Christ, the living word, then, who was manifested in Jesus, is the same Christ, the living word, who lives in our hearts today as Christians. See, the spoken living word. When God teaches us, and Jesus says in, see, John 6:45, and they shall all be taught of God, every man therefore that heard and learned of the Father cometh unto me. So when Jesus teaches us that we're a sinner, and we accept it, he teaches that Jesus is the only answer for our sins, we've got to accept that. But then we have to respond by saying, Lord, please forgive me of my sins. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So we respond then correctly by humbling ourselves to God's word, saying, Lord Jesus, please forgive me. Come into my heart and save me. See, so that then is how we receive Christ into our heart. He won't come in uninvited. And the devil will do everything he can to cause people to just say, well, I believe in God. I believe in Jesus, you know. And I've been going to church for all these years. You know, I've been a deacon, or, you know, a deacon's wife or something like that. And I've served on these different boards and everything. But that is not what makes you a Christian. Making you a Christian is you humbled yourself according to God's word. And the devil will try to cause you out of pride to think of all these great things you've done. That I believe God is real, and I believe Jesus is his son, and things like this. And you know that, and you have confidence in it, because see, God has taught you that. But also that we must humble ourselves to his word and respond to him and invite him to come into our hearts. And that is how we become a child of God and born into the family of God. Like, you know, Ezekiel 36:26 again, a new heart also will give you, a new spirit will I put within you. I'll take away the stony heart out of your flesh, give you a heart of flesh, and I'll put my spirit in you. Now, when his spirit comes to live and abide in us, he cleans us up, or he creates in us a new heart and everything. But then now God is living in our heart. We're in union with him by his spirit in us. We're children of God. And Galatians 4:6 says, and because you're sons, God has sent forth the spirit of his son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So our response to knowing the living word, knowing the gospel, to knowing any of God's word, the only positive response has got to be from us accepting and receiving that word from God into our heart. And that's what it means when it says that, but without faith, it's impossible to please God. Because without receiving his spirit of his words, and his words are spirit and life to us, without receiving them, inviting them to come into our heart, it's just head knowledge. For an example, you know, like a James 2:19 says, the devils believe and tremble. Well, when Jesus came in the presence of the demons, they cried out, Jesus, thou son of the most high God, why do you torment us for our time? They knew who Jesus was. They confessed Jesus. They knew their time was coming. And they knew it wasn't then. They knew it was, you know, later. So they saying, Jesus, thou son of the most high God, why do you torment us for our time? See, perfect words of faith, not perfect words of faith, but perfect words of truth there. They knew their time was coming, and it wasn't yet. They knew he was the son of God, and they spoke it and confessed it. But see, that wasn't salvation to them. And just knowing and speaking God's word, well, like in Matthew chapter 7, Jesus says, many are going to say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not done these great and wonderful works? We've cast out demons in your name. We've, you know, done so many other things. See, people that know that God is real, know that Jesus is his son, and going around. And you say, well, how could they do all those great works then? Because, see, they were quoting God's word, and God was backing up his word, even though it was not in their heart. See, God even backed up his word through a donkey back in Numbers, you know, to Balaam, the prophet Balaam and everything. God will back up his word regardless of who speaks it, if they speak his pure, true word. Now, and a lot of people are going to be misled by that, because they'll you know, be preaching and stuff. Like my friend had preached for several years. He had seen people get saved. He had seen great things happen. But that night, when he was leading the, you know, invitation and asking people to come and surrender their lives to the Lord and invite him to come in their heart and commit their life to him, the voice of God spoke to him and said, you've never done that yourself. And he realized then that he had been just, you know, carrying the message to others, but the message wasn't in his own heart. He was doing it out of just an intellectual type effort. And Jesus says, Matthew chapter 7, that many going to say to him that day, Lord, Lord, have we not done these great and wonderful works? He's going to say, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. See, workers of iniquity, their hearts still fill with that iniquity and everything. They haven't received the changed heart, the changed life. Now, Jesus was very different than us here on earth. Because when he was born of God, his heavenly Father, with the young lady Mary. God was his father, and young virgin Mary, who was espoused to be married to Joseph, was Jesus' mother. The scripture states in Luke 1:26-38 that God sent the angel Gabriel to tell Mary about what was to come to pass. In verse 27, Mary was described as an unmarried virgin. In verse 28, the angel said she was highly favored. Now see, favor is an Old Testament relationship between someone and God. God's mercy, or God's love to people, one-way love. That's all they had in the Old Testament and his word. See, Psalms 25:10 says, mercy and truth were all the ways of the Lord to those who accepted his word and, you know, obeyed his testimonies and covenants. So for all the godly people of the Old Testament, all they had was God's love, mercy on them, to them, and his word to them. His living word, Christ, to them. It said that she was highly favored. Now, highly favored, you know, if God was pleased with somebody in the Old Testament, he didn't just meet their needs. He met their needs, and then he just blessed them with more so they could have plenty to share with other people. Because God's will for the Jews in the Old Testament was that they be his example to the world of how he treated his people. Psalm 67, David says, God be merciful and bless us and cause your way to shine upon us, that your way may be known on earth, your saving health among all the nations. See, they were supposed to have been his priests to the world. The Levites were the priests to the Jews, the Jewish nation, but all of the Jews were supposed to have been priests to the people of the world to show God's love and blessing and to draw them to him. Now, so the angel said to her, highly favored, the Lord was with her, and she was blessed among women. The angel said for her to fear not, for she had found favor with God. See, favor, mercy and favor of the Old Testament. In fact, the word grace was misinterpreted or miswritten in the Old Testament 70 to 80 times. And every time the word grace was incorrectly written into the Old Testament, it should have been favor or mercy. Two or three times it should have been mercy. Most of the time it should have been favor. If you look that up and study it, you'll see that there was no grace in the Old Testament until Jesus came in the fullness of grace. She was told she would conceive, bring forth a son, and call his name Jesus. Now, that living word of God through the angel to Mary was the seed that caused her to conceive and bring forth the son Jesus. And the Spirit of God was in her conception, in Jesus, throughout the period of time of the 9 months before he was born and everything. And when he was born, he had the Spirit of God in him that time. The only time he didn't have the Spirit of God in him was that last bit of time before he died on the cross, when he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? See, he had never known any sin. He had never known any separation of his heart from God until he died for us and took our sins on the cross. And that was the man Jesus. Now, and she was told to call his name Jesus. The angel said he'd be great and he'd be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God would give him the throne of David, and he would reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom would have no end. And the angel said Jesus would be called the Son of God. Now, Mary was highly favored, young girl, it says. But nowhere in the scripture is it ever indicated and stated that she was sinless or our mediator with God. The only sinless person was Jesus, and our mediator between us and God was to be Jesus too, except God was so pleased with him that he exalted him through that position to the fullness of the Godhead bodily. So Jesus became then equality with God and the Spirit of Christ, God's spoken living word, into the Trinity. The only sinless person. Now, Mary was a common young lady who happened to have a very special calling of service, as did Abraham, Jacob, Esther, John the Baptist, and other people. And like each of us, we have special holy callings. 2 Timothy again, 1:9, who saved us and called us to a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. We each have a special holy calling. And we normally must have to really, seek and search for it, because we have to care enough about God and his love and everything that we will actually, want to know what it is. In fact, in August, after I became a Christian in 1974, just a couple of months of being a Christian, God told me in a dream that I was going to preach and teach on the radio. At that time, I didn't even know there was such a thing as a Christian radio station or, something like that. I didn't know, except on Sunday morning when, they had shut down the country and western stations and let people preach and things like that. That was the only thing that I had known about then, because all my stations were set and I listened to them, and the messages came on Sunday morning. But many people teach, because it stated that Mary was highly favored, that it meant Mary was full or endowed with grace. No, see, grace is a work of the Spirit of God in our heart. Any work of the Spirit. See, now, the first work of the Spirit in our heart is like in Ephesians 2:8, where it says we're saved by grace through faith. So if we accept and obey God's word and accept that we're a sinner and accept that Jesus answered, and then we humble ourselves and accept into our heart the words of the gospel, then the words are alive in spirit, Jesus says. So when they come into our heart, that work of the Spirit then of his word into our heart creates in us a new heart, a new life, what we call the work of grace for salvation. But see, that work of grace is a response, though, of Christ in our heart to us inviting and letting the living word in, inviting the living word into our heart. But to be endowed with grace, that only Jesus is the only one that had grace in the Old Testament. And I'll be right back and continue that in just a couple of minutes.
Tornado season has once again arrived in the southern plains. Moore, Oklahoma, a suburb of Oklahoma City, has seen its share of Mother Nature's power. Southgate Elementary School in Moore suffered heavy damage after severe weather hit the area.
Debris everywhere, a roof destroyed, and a community left once again picking up the pieces. Southgate Elementary took a direct hit in Wednesday night's tornado.
About 10 classrooms at Southgate Elementary in Moore have either structural or water damage. Citizens can help the rebuilding process by donating to Southgate Teachers as they work to request the items they need to rebuild their classrooms.
please help by going to donorschoice.org. This organization helped raise $600,000 for the Moore community after the May 2013 tornado. Also, contact your local Red Cross chapter. This has been a public service announcement from your friends at K98Talk.com and the Spark Radio Network. God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin can now be heard on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday mornings at 7 a.m. Central, 8 Eastern, and on Sunday mornings at his regular time, 6 Central, 7 Eastern. Join with him and let's turn our country back to God. It only takes a spark to start a forest fire. Let's get on fire for the Lord. Right here on K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network. Now back to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin.
Welcome back. We were just reading and discussing and some information about Jesus and his birth. Now, that even though Mary was highly favored, she was not filled with and endowed with grace. Grace is a work of the Spirit of God in any form that we call him, the Spirit of Christ, the Spirit of God, the Spirit of, you know, grace, truth. Anyway, God's Spirit in our heart is what we call the work of grace. And the work of grace at salvation is when, like the prophet Ezekiel said in Ezekiel 36:26, which I repeat so many times, it's such a clear definition, almost definition, of the work of grace. He says, a new heart also I give you. Whatever it takes to give us a new heart is part of the work of grace. A new heart also I give you. A new spirit will I put within you. As he's putting his spirit in us, that's a work of grace, because, you know, his spirit working in our heart is what we would call grace. A new heart also will give you, a new spirit will put within you. I'll take away the stony heart out of your flesh. However he goes about that, that's part of the work of grace for salvation. So I'll give you a new heart, and it's going to be a new cleansed heart. So we all come into the, you know, the body of Christ with a with the same new perfect cleansed heart by, you know, it's cleansed by God. A new heart also will give you, a new spirit will I put within. I take away the stony heart of flesh, give you heart of flesh, and I'll put my spirit in you. See, he doesn't just stop with cleaning us up and cleaning our hearts and giving us, you know, this good new heart and everything. He comes to live in our heart. The people of the Old Testament didn't have that. All they had, they got forgiveness through their sacrifices and everything. But then their sins were just covered until the, you know, the next time they went to offer sacrifices to get the sins forgiven again. They didn't get to change heart. They didn't become children of God. His spirit wasn't living in them. And like Colossians 1:27, Christ in us, our hope of glory. And we know that Christ lives in us because of the things he's done and stuff like this. Now, John 17:17, Jesus in his prayer said, thy word is truth. So Jesus came in the fullness of grace and truth. In fullness of God's word, fullness of grace. The scripture stated in John 1:14-17. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father. The only begotten of the Father now. Because, see, God was his Father. And Mary conceived by that living Word that God sent to her through the angel. We beheld his glory and glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So he was full of grace, the work of God's Spirit in his heart. He was filled with the Spirit and truth, God's Word. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Now, see, he says Jesus Christ here, but see, grace came by Jesus, who was filled with Christ. Now, the scriptures do not tell when Jesus received the fullness of grace. Now, this is something you may not have heard before, and you need to think and consider this, because when you see what it says in the scriptures, we accept that as God's word to us. The scriptures do not tell when Jesus received the fullness of grace. And you say, well, it says he came in the fullness of grace. He was just born that way. No, he wasn't. The Spirit of his Father working in his heart in the fullness of truth. His Father's living word filling him. Now, that would be the fullness of grace and truth, would be that he had all of the, you know, he just filled with the Spirit, and he had all of God's word. But now listen in Luke chapter 2, verse 52. Luke chapter 2, verse 52. And Mary found Jesus in the temple. You know, when they went to the sacrifice and everything, went to the celebrations, and as they were leaving to go back home, Mary and Joseph then missed Jesus. They went back to look for him, and they found him in the temple where he was, you know, talking with the elders and discussing the scriptures and everything. Well, in Luke 2:49, listen to scripture. Jesus stated in Luke 2:49 that he knew he should be about his Father's business. But in verse 52, right after that, the scripture says, and Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. Now, wisdom is God's word. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 24, it says, Christ, the living word. Now, it says Christ, the power of God, you know, the creating power of God is God's living word. Christ, the power of God, and wisdom of God. So Christ, the spoken living word of God, is the wisdom of God. But here at age 12, it says that Jesus increased in wisdom. That means he increased in more of God's living word. He increased in stature and in favor with God and man. Now, if he had been filled with the Spirit of God at that time, at age 12, and the Spirit of his, you know, words, his living word, word and truth, he couldn't have increased any more. If Jesus at age 12 had been filled then with grace, Christ in his heart to the fullness, and the fullness of God's truth, God's word, then there would not have been any means by which he could have continued to grow any more in wisdom and favor with God, because Christ, the living word of God, is God's wisdom, and truth is God's word. Therefore, Jesus would have already grown to the fullness of the Spirit. See, so that at age 12, he was not filled with the Spirit of grace and truth. He was growing in it. Now, however you want to, you know, think about that, just pray about it, because it's in the scripture, so we must deal with and accept it. The Apostle Paul stated in Galatians 4:1-2, now I say that the heir, as long as he's a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all, but is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father. See, now he did grow into the fullness, because the scripture says he came in the fullness of grace and truth. Now here, Paul could have been describing how Jesus grew in wisdom and favor until age 30, which is the starting age of priests. God gave in Numbers chapter 4, verse 43, that priests start at age 30. They start kind of like an on-job training at age 25, and then 30, the fullness of you being a priest, till about age 50, and then they became elders serving in the temple. Nevertheless, we know that John states in John 1:14, Jesus came in the fullness of grace and truth when he started his ministry. Now, how he grew into that, well, this is something that doesn't explain clearly here and everything, but it does say he came in the fullness, and we have to grow in measures to be like him. That is, the more of God's living word, the more we study his word, the more he puts in our heart, the more then we're filling up with his word and his Spirit of his words in us. Jesus was conceived in the womb by the young Virgin Mary, by the seed of God, the Father, through the living word Christ, that was spoken through the angel that God sent to him. The Apostle Luke states that Jesus as a youth grew in wisdom and favor with God and man in Luke 2:52. At some time before the start of his ministry, Jesus grew into the fullness of the Spirit, because the Apostle John states in 1:14, "And the Word was made flesh and dwelled among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." Now, that living Word that was conceived in the womb of young Virgin Mary, it's like in 1 Peter 1:23, it says, "We are born by an incorruptible seed, by the Word of God, living and abiding forever." See, when we're born into the family of God, and when He comes in to create us a new heart, a new life, and puts His Spirit in us, see, it's that same Spirit, that seed of God. Well, what's it, Romans 4:13? Way to Abraham or his seed, but through the righteousness of faith. It's the seed of God spoken to Mary by the angel, the living Word, that, you know, she conceived by that living Word. Well, we're born into the family of God by the incorruptible seed, which liveth and abideth forever. We were born into this physical life by the corruptible seed from our dads here on earth, but born into the family of God, and that's what it means to be born again. And Jesus says in John chapter 3 that we must be born again, and that's being born into the family of God. Now, Jesus was, or God was, dissatisfied with his covenant of the Old Testament. And the personal relationship that existed between him and mankind during the Old Testament period. God speaks through the scriptures of the Old Testament covenant. Hebrews chapter 8 says, "But now he," Jesus, "obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is a mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises." See, so whatever promise you can find in the Old Testament, if it's, you know, if it's a good one, it, you know, it's got to be a good one if God made a promise to him. But the scripture says here that Jesus was a mediator of that better covenant when he was here on earth. And how could it be a better covenant? Because, well, his death and burial, you know, his death on the cross, his sacrifice and everything, he is the foundation of all the promises to us now. And he's already fulfilled all those without sin, and he's already had victory over death and all this. See, so all of his work has been done, and we're on such a firm foundation of Jesus and his walk of faith and eternal sacrifice for us. And it continues on and says, "When there are better promises, for if that first covenant had been faultless," the first covenant faultless, it's actually saying here that something God created was, you know, faulty. And God thought so too, because he didn't like that relationship with mankind that he had established in the Old Testament. It says, "For if the first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for a second." And then people that say that God doesn't change, well, yes, he does. He changed his covenant, in fact, with mankind. Now, what it means by when it says God doesn't change, it means his love for people. He always loves people. He always thinks good for us. And he always thinks, you know, for our best interest and what he wants us to do. And he tries to lead and guide us into doing, you know, that special holy, or entering into that holy calling he's got for us, because he knows that's going to be what's best for us, because he created us, and he created us to have the talents and capabilities and things like this to use in that special holy calling. He knows what's best for us, and he tries to lead us to that. And he does make changes. He changes when we pray a lot of times, like 2 Kings chapter 20. It was time for him to call King Hezekiah home. He said, "Set your house in order. You're going to die." He sent prophet Isaiah to tell him that. Well, Isaiah turned and prayed and talked to the Lord. And then God sent Isaiah back and said, "Tell him I heard his prayers. I saw his tears. And I'll heal him and give him 15 more years." See, God changed because Hezekiah turned and prayed and talked to him. And God is not a respecter of persons. He didn't respect Hezekiah because he was king. He respected him because Hezekiah tried to be a good king, a godly king. And if you're listening this morning out there, start praying and seeking, you know, like that about your situation. God changes situations a lot of them. Well, like, for example, the book of Jonah. God sent Jonah to the Ninevites and said, set your house in order. You're going to die in 40 days. He was going to destroy them. They were so evil and everything. But the old evil king says to his people, says, maybe God will change if we humble ourselves and turn to him. And they did. They put on sackcloth and ashes, and all of them prayed and sought the Lord. And then God didn't destroy them. He forgave them. And it made Jonah mad. But see, God changes circumstances. When it says that God doesn't change, what it means is that he won't change his like characteristics of loving all of us and you know, caring for us and things like this, and backing up his promises and stuff like this. He doesn't change in those ways. But he changes when we talk to him in prayer a lot of times. So this morning, whatever your problem or concern is like that, take it to the Lord in prayer. It just might be that that's not God's will for you. If it's not, he'll change. Okay. Now, for if the first covenant had been faultless, then should there have been no place to have sought for the second. And God wanted a better relationship with us. For finding fault with them, God said, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. God desired that better covenant. And again, it's discussed and described in Ezekiel 36, the promise of the Spirit. And I've said it already about four or five times. And I hope you don't ever get tired of hearing it. But that new covenant and the promise of the Spirit, a lot of denominations teach the promise of the Spirit is after we get saved, that God will have us speak in tongues or something. That's not the promise of the Spirit. The promise of the Spirit is here in Ezekiel 36:26, that we're going to go from just a creature that has a heart full of lust and sin and, you know, just a separation from God and lust for money, lust for sex, lust for pride, lust for, you know, jobs and things like this. All these lusts and things like this. We're going to go from an evil heart like that to a clean heart, and he's going to put his Spirit of love in us. See, that's a promise of the Spirit to us. Ezekiel 36:26-27 says, a new heart also will give you. A new spirit will I put within you, and I'll take away the stony heart out of your flesh, give you a heart of flesh, and I'll put my Spirit in you. See, putting his Spirit of love in us, where we had it filled with just hate and bitterness and lust and greed and things like this. Such a change. He's going to make such a change in us. And that is fantastic. If you've never recognized in your life when you've just turned to God and cried out, oh Lord, forgive me, come into my heart and cleanse me. And you know that Jesus responded and put his Spirit back in your heart and created you a new heart and everything. If you do not know for sure that's happened to you. And you can't not know it if it's happened, because see, you're the one that asked him to come do it. So when he comes to do it, you'll know he's done it. Start praying and seeking and say, Lord, give me that new heart. Put your Spirit in me. Please help me to know for sure I'm one of your children and I'm not misled in any way. But I want to know that when I stand before you, that I'll be one of your children. And you say, welcome home, my child. And hopefully, well done, my good and faithful child. Something like that, my servant. But anyway, the new Spirit that God puts in us is the same living Word, Spirit of Christ, the Holy Spirit that lived in Jesus. You know, Jesus received the Spirit in him by accepting and obeying his Father's Word and receiving his Father's Word in him. We can have the same faith that Jesus had if we will receive and accept God the Father's Word in us too. But now it's Jesus speaking his Word to us. But if we receive God's Word into our heart, we'll have the same Spirit of faith in us that Jesus had. Now, it is a promise, the Spirit of promise that God made to mankind above, that he would put his Spirit in us. And that is what's so great about the difference between the Old Covenant and New Covenant. When we turn to the Lord with all our heart, we come out of it then by receiving His Spirit in us and becoming a child of God. The people of the Old Testament received forgiveness, and then their sins were covered. They still had that separation in their heart from God, and they didn't get the joy of that new relationship. They didn't get that joy of Christ in them, the Spirit of God in them. And if you don't recognize that joy in your heart, start praying and seeking until you know for sure that He does live in your heart. Because, you know, everybody ought to know that that has been filled with hate and lust and all this stuff, and then having that Spirit of love come in the place of it, and a new, pure heart. That is so great. And that's what happened to me back in 1974, and I haven't shut up about it yet, and I'm not going to till I leave this earth. Because everybody needs to know, I don't care who it is, it's some Muslim, some, you know, Hindu, some your neighbor next door, or anybody you meet, all of our hearts are created alike to have that void that only Jesus and His living Word can fill for us. But He'll only do it when we invite Him to come in. Now, and again, several Pentecostal denominations, a couple other groups, teach that the promise of the Spirit is speaking in unknown tongues. No, that's a gift of the Spirit, one of the gifts of the Spirit. Back here it says to edify the believer, but it's not the promise of the Spirit that we were given from God. The promise of the Spirit was that He's going to come and He and His Spirit, you know, live in us. That we're going to be His child now, not just a new type creature or something like that. It says, you know, in, what is it, Ephesians, excuse me, 2 Corinthians 5:17, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. But a new creature then, because we didn't have the Spirit of God in us before. See, and now we're a new creature in the universe. We are a child of God. The promise of the Spirit is that God promised to put His Spirit into our hearts. And He creates in us at salvation when He receives us into the family. We're united with God by His Spirit in our new hearts. We're His children. Okay, the people of the Old Testament only had God's mercy. Psalms 25:10, all the paths of the Lord are mercy and truth to such as keep His covenant and His testimony. And then in Isaiah 59:21, He says, this is my covenant with them. I put my Spirit on them. See, that's mercy. And my words in their mouth. See, that's truth. God's words are truth. So it's mercy and truth is all they had, it says in Isaiah. And I'm going to continue this message possibly in the morning in my message. There's 10 other scriptures that I have here that I won't read them to you now, but to talk about mercy and truth in the Old Testament. And see, and in none of those does it say, like here in Psalms 25:10, all the paths of the Lord, mercy and truth, to such as keep His covenants and His testimonies. Now see, it doesn't say anything here about and Jesus. See, people say that Jesus was in the Old Testament. No, He wasn't. He was born and as a man raised, walked in the fullness of Christ in Him, perfect walk of faith, shedding His blood on the cross to die for us. And then when the Spirit of God left Him, see, Jesus was still the man on the cross. The man who had the perfect walk of faith for our sacrifice and everything took our sins upon Him during that time after the Spirit of Christ left Him. And God was so pleased with Him that He exalted Him to the fullness of the Godhead bodily to be in equality with God and the Spirit of Christ, the Holy Spirit, into a Trinity relationship. Jesus wasn't God before then. He wasn't God in that time. Because listen, Isaiah 59:21. Here, Jesus not mentioned, says, my Spirit on them, my words in their mouth. See, that was the relationship of the people of the Old Testament. And I've got a lot more of those scriptures here I'd like to share, where it was just God the Father and His living Word, Christ. See, God the Father, to Moses, in it says in Hebrews 11:26, and Moses esteemed the riches of Christ greater. See, that's His living Word to Moses. Jesus wasn't in the Old Testament. And under the New Covenant, you know, like this, the Godhead becomes a Trinity type relationship. We become a child of God. What a great change from the Old Covenant to the New Covenant. The great New Covenant relationship with God offers mankind under the New Covenant results in us, the lowly creatures of His creation. Now see, He doesn't love us anymore now that we're one of His children. He loved us with a perfect love when we were born on this earth without His Spirit in us. His love for us doesn't change by anything we do. But see, He is so pleased with us now as being His children. And that's what we're seeking to do as we serve Him. We're not seeking to work and do things now that will, you know, add to our salvation or anything. Because, you know, once we're a child of God, that's eternal life. My eternal life started 40 years ago when I received, 41 years now. But anyway, when I received Christ in my heart that night. See, my eternal life started then. So, my service for the Lord right now has nothing to do with my eternal life. It has to do with pleasing my Heavenly Father, though. It has to do with when He calls me out of this life, that He's going to say, "Welcome home, son. Welcome now. Your service is over," or something like that. But we're no longer a servant like that, serving Him to try to reach others. But see, it has nothing to do with my eternal life now. I'm eternally saved from the time He created in me that new heart. Because see, only Christ can change a heart. The power of God, again, Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 24, Christ, the power of God. He's the power of God, the creating power of God, the creating force of the universe, Christ. And that creating force of the universe came into my heart then in 1974, created in me the new heart, the new life, and put His Spirit in me for eternal life. And Jesus says that all that my Father gives me, I will in no way lose any of them. He's not going to let any of us go. And that's ridiculous to think any of us even want to. The ones that would even discuss that silly option would be people who have never received Christ in their heart. They're just like I was mentioning earlier, believers. They believe that God is real. They know that God is real, but they haven't received Him in their heart. Once you receive Him into your heart and you know that Christ lives in you, you would never even consider wanting to go back to the old empty heart filled or empty heart without the Spirit of God. See, it's a ridiculous possibility. But anyway, you need to know what it is to receive a changed heart if you haven't. Start praying and seeking, and somehow or another God will reveal it to you, because see, it won't just happen. Jeremiah 29:13 and Deuteronomy chapter 6, it says, "You shall seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart." And, you know, like in Psalms 91:1, where it says, "He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide in the shadow of the Almighty." It's not secret because God hides it from us. It's secret because you've got to be concerned enough and love God enough or something to want to know what God has for you. And in Galatians 4:4-7, "But when the fullness of time has come, God sent forth His Son." See, when the fullest of time, He sent forth His Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. So we're adopted from our earthly creature status to our earthly parents. We're adopted into the family of God. "And because you're sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father." Now, Abba, Father means Daddy, Father. "Wherefore thou art no more a servant, but a son, and if a son, then heir of God through Christ." I am a child of God here serving my Father. You know, and I'm not doing it, you know, to get there or anything. He's already given me eternal life. He's already taken away that separation of my heart. When Jesus died, He received that separation, all the sins, and then died. See, when we die, when I die, my earthly body here will just fall off and I'll keep going. There won't be an instant in that process that I'm separated from my Heavenly Father. See, I have eternal life now. Never to die the physical death like that, to where be separated from God again like Jesus did on the cross. Okay.
Now
the leader in talk radio on the internet, right here on K98Talk.com. The staff of K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network is proud to announce that our very own Rowdy Rick Robinson has been selected as one of the top conservative talk show hosts in the nation for his program, America Off the Rails. Again, congratulations to Rowdy Rick Robinson for a job well done and another reason to stay connected to K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network. God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin can now be heard on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday mornings at 7 a.m. Central, 8 Eastern, and on Sunday mornings at his regular time, 6 Central, 7 Eastern. Join with him and let's turn our country back to God. It only takes a spark to start a forest fire. Let's get on fire for the Lord, right here on K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network.
I just played a public service announcement before that one, but I noticed at the end of it that I had it muted so you didn't hear it. So I'll return and play that announcement now.
Tornado season has once again arrived in the southern plains. Moore, Oklahoma, a suburb of Oklahoma City, has seen its share of Mother Nature's power. Southgate Elementary School in Moore suffered heavy damage after severe weather hit the area.
Debris everywhere, a roof destroyed, and a community left once again picking up the pieces. Southgate Elementary took a direct hit in Wednesday night's tornado.
About 10 classrooms at Southgate Elementary and Moore have either structural or water damage. Citizens can help the rebuilding process by donating to Southgate teachers as they work to request the items they need to rebuild their classrooms. Please help by going to donorschoice.org. This organization helped raise $600,000 for the Moore community after the May 2013 tornado. Also, contact your local Red Cross chapter. This has been a public service announcement from your friends at K98Talk.com and the Spark Radio Network. Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books. Now back to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin.
Welcome back. Now we're going into the final segment of our broadcast for today. I've been discussing, you know, some of the things about Jesus that you may not have heard before about his at age 12, the encounter there in the temple, to where it says that Jesus grew in stature and favor. Well, Jesus did grow into the fullness of Godhead bodily, into the fullness of the Spirit of grace and truth. And then after his manly service here on earth with Christ in him, you know, like that, when he died on the cross, took our sins as our scapegoat, sins away, we never have to face that separation in our heart again as God's children. When we die this physical death, we just go off in the Spirit to be with God. Now, that is such a great feeling to know that, too. Not only did Jesus provide a means for forgiveness of our sins, for our sin debt, his death on the cross, he also later provided, through his resurrection, a spiritual means to change our old hearts and new hearts, Jesus as the seed and God as our Father. So, that is so special. That's the reason I'm here. That's the reason I'm sharing, is because I may not be the best Christian on earth, but I sure hope that I can help some of you become a Christian for the joy of having received him into my heart and life. I've been in Bible studies through the years, and so often people will make comments like, we need the faith of Jesus, or we need the faith of God, you know, as if our faith isn't enough. And I'll say that faith always comes, or faith is a word we use to describe that when God manifests himself to us, you know, like when God somehow or other manifests in our mind or heart a message, we say God spoke to me or something, or God came to me or whatever. But when God does this and we know it's God's manifesting that message to us or speaking to us, Romans 10:17 says faith comes by hearing, hearing the word of God. But only if we accept in agreement and receive his word into our heart. Now, John 15:7, Jesus says, if ye abide in me, and my words abide in you. So when Jesus speaks, he says, my words abide in you. See, we must receive his words into us and accept and do our best to obey to be walking by faith daily. And what I mean by that is, you say, oh, well, if Jesus speaks to me, well, I'll do it. But see, in 1 Corinthians 2:10-11. That's it. 1 Corinthians 2:10-11 says, forgive others, lest you give Satan the advantage. Now, see, that's Jesus' word to us today, that we should forgive others. And we should do that if we love him. He says throughout the scriptures, if you love me, obey my commandments. So now, if we're holding unforgiveness toward anybody, not only are we disobeying our Heavenly Father, not only are we disobeying Jesus, his word to us to forgive others, but during that time, it is so serious, we are also giving Satan the advantage in our life to cause us to be out of fellowship. See, as God's children, he doesn't want us running around rejecting his word, his instructions for us what to do. But not only that, when we do that, we're actually putting ourselves in fellowship with the devil, you might say, during that time. But we're giving the devil advantage. And John 10:10 says, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And during that time, he's going to bring sickness upon you. He's going to bring any other kind of destruction he can upon you. And so we need, and when we're walking by faith and daily have the opportunities to accept his word to faith, which is to forgive others, if we don't, see, we're going to start receiving the curses from the devil and things. That's why so many Christians across our nation are in hospitals today. And that's why there's so many, you know, sick and all this, because of failing to close that door to the devil by saying, Lord, please help me to forgive so-and-so. Please help me to forgive them. I don't want that unforgiveness in my heart. I want your love in my heart and everything. And also, you know, like it says, husbands, and what is it, 1 Peter 3:7, husbands, dwell with your wives according to knowledge, being joint heirs of grace life, as unto the weaker vessel, lest your prayers be hindered. You know, that can cause, you know, breaking relationships and things like this can cause our prayers to be hindered because we aren't allowing Jesus' words to abide in us. He says, if ye abide in me and my words abide in you, ask what you will. But see, when we're out of fellowship with what we know the Scripture's teaching us do, pray for those who despitefully use us, you know, seek the Lord. It says it's evil not to seek the Lord. 2 Chronicles 12:14 says Rehoboam, Solomon's son, did evil because he prepared not his heart to seek the Lord. See, we have a responsibility as his children not to do these things to try to earn our salvation or something like that. See, when Christ came in our heart, we received salvation then. We became a child of God then. It's just to live here pleasing to our Heavenly Father and serve him in a way that, you know, that he wants us to. Knowing his words is not the same as receiving his words. Again, like I said in Hebrews 4:2, it says people can even know the gospel. For unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. And then Psalms 119:9, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto according to God's word. People can go to church a lot. People can preach. People can sing in the choir. People can be choir directors without having the Spirit of Christ in their heart. They can do it based on talents and things they've learned here on earth, you know, how to play pianos, how to sing and do this and everything. Now, regardless of how God reveals his word or will, or how we come to understand his word or will, when we hear his word, we must accept his word to faith in our hearts, or with an evil heart, reject his word to unbelief. It says in Hebrews chapter 3, verses 12 through 19, that the children of Israel failed to enter a promised land because of not doubt, but unbelief. They didn't trust God enough to accept his word to cross over the promised land, that he would take care of them after seeing all those miracles and everything like that. And it says they failed to enter in because of an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. See, the living God, he and his word are alive in us, a spirit, and are alive. And we reject his will and his word. We're rejecting the living God. Christ is a living word in us. And we reject the living word, we're rejecting a living God. Okay. We do not have faith until we make a choice to receive and accept God's word into our heart. Now, another way, we do not accept God's word by faith. See, when God speaks to us, we don't have faith and accept his word. When God speaks to us, we have to make the choice right then to accept his word to faith. You know, because if we choose to reject his word, we're rejecting it to unbelief. See, so when we receive his word, we make the choice whether it becomes unbelief to us or faith to us, by which we say. Now, to show us a perfect walk of obedience, Jesus said in John 5:19 of himself, verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing himself but what he seeth the Father do, for what things soever he doeth, these things he doeth the Son likewise. And in John 5:30, I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just, because I seek not my will, but the will of the Father that sent me. See, so his faith was acceptance and obedience to his Father's word. Our faith is acceptance and obedience of our Father's word. So if we want to have the faith like Jesus, well, you know, we can't have his faith, because, you know, he lived by his faith. We got to be living by our faith. Now, in Jesus, in John chapter 10 and Matthew 26 and Luke 22, he said he didn't have to give up his life for us, but he chose to give his life in agreement with his Father's will. Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life that I might take it again. No man taketh it from me, but I lay it down myself. I have the power to lay it down and the power to take it up. This commandment I have received of the Father. And, you know, he voluntarily took upon him our sin that we might be forgiven of it. Now, some people say that Jesus forgave our sins on the cross and everything. No, he made potential for our sins to be forgiven. We have to receive God's word in our heart. We have to ask forgiveness of our sins. And then when we do, then He forgives our sins when we ask, but He didn't forgive the sins on the cross. He forgave, you know, or he asked His Father to forgive those that were persecuting Him then and everything and crucifying Him because they knew not what they were doing. But He made potential for our sins to be forgiven, for all of our sins to be forgiven, for us to come into fellowship with God and become a child of God, and that total separation of our heart from God to be filled with God and His Spirit. Now, He made that potential on the cross for us, but everybody does not choose to receive that payment. Like in Romans 6, 23, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God's eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Many people turn and do not receive that gift for different reasons. Some because, you know, they've been hurt by ministers. They've known people that were Christians. And we need to be living the kind of life to be an encouragement for people to turn to the Lord and to receive Him as their personal Lord and Savior, that they can see in us something that they're missing and that they need and they feel like they want. But that's not happening in our society. In our society, it's people want to get rid of Christians. If there's a problem, you know, like in Washington something, they don't say, send me some Christians, you know, to talk to or something. They say, get rid of the Christians so we can work on the problem, so we can do something. Our society has just flipped in the years since it was formed of being a godly nation. Now it's run by such ungodly laws and ungodly people and everything like that. And it seems to be getting worse. Well, we've got to be sharing. And Jesus says, if we don't confess Him before men, He won't confess us before the angels of God and like that. So a lot of people are failing to get answers to prayer because of only just calling out when they need something. Now, in God's mercy, He'll answer us a lot of times and bypass His regular rules. But like it says in Revelation 12:11, they overcame Him, speaking of the devil, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. See, that's how important our testimony is. And Jesus says in John chapter 8, verses 20 and 29, when you have lifted up the Son of Man, you shall know that I am He and that I do nothing myself, but as my Father has taught me, I speak these things. And He that sent me is with me. The Father has not left me alone, for I do always those things that please Him. And we lift up the Son of Man. When we lift up Jesus in our daily life, like at a grocery store or the gas station or other places we go, we lift Him up and tell people what He's done for us. You know, that then will give them an encouragement. When somebody asks you to pray for them, don't just say, oh, yes, okay, I'll pray for you, something like that. Pray with them then if you can, because when whatever it is that is asking you to pray for them about, when they hear your prayer and you're praying to God and you're asking Him to do something to help the person, then when God does it, they'll see and know that's an answer to prayer. And Jesus says, if He be lifted up, He'll draw men unto Him. And that it is so important, our testimonies, to overcome, you know, the devil. And they overcome him, the devil, by the blood of the Lamb, what Jesus has already done for us, and by the word of their testimony. So Jesus' faith, He lived by His faith, by acceptance and obedience to His Father's word. We must live by our faith, our acceptance and obedience to God's word. So we don't need Jesus' faith. We need the result of Jesus serving by His faith, you know, becoming our sacrifice and becoming, you know, our Savior. But we have to live by our faith. And in, say, 1 John 5:4, it says, this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. And then in Ephesians 6:16, it says to put on the shield of faith. That means we've got to be shielded from the devil and all the fiery darts of the devil and everything by our acceptance and obedience to God's word. See, we have to make the choice to do that. We have to be seeking in God's word His promises for protection, for deliverance, for these things like this. And then accepting and obeying His word. Now, it is so serious, you know, that we need to be studying to become the kind of people that God wants us to be. And I'll be discussing some more of this tomorrow, and I hope you'll be back with me then. But right now, I want to share with you something. I'll be right back after this short message.
God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin can now be heard on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday mornings at 7 a.m. Central, 8 Eastern, and on Sunday mornings at his regular time, 6 Central, 7 Eastern. Join with him and let's turn our country back to God. It only takes a spark to start a forest fire. Let's get on fire for the Lord. Right here on K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network.
Welcome back. I've been sharing throughout this about how to become a child of God. And right now, I want to invite you, if you've never received Christ in your heart, to do that with me. And let me just go over a little information here. The promise of God to cleanse and give us a new heart that He will live in as our Father is given in Ezekiel 36:26, which I've quoted several times here this morning about the new heart, and He'll put His Spirit in us, and He'll, you know, live in us. And God has made it so easy for us to invite Him into our hearts by just asking Jesus to forgive our sins and invite Jesus to send His Spirit, Christ, to create in us our new cleansed hearts. In our new clean hearts, our request must be sincere and wholehearted to want to be free of our sins and to be cleansed from our sins. Because God's Word states in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. For us to repent and ask for forgiveness means that we want Him to cleanse us from the sins too. We can't just become a child of God or a son of God and ask Him, you know, to forgive our sins and not cleanse us from it. Because that wouldn't make sense, that we're turning from our sins to Him. And some people say that, you know, well, I took Jesus as my Savior and then I took Him as my Lord. No, we want Him to come in, and we got to be praying with a repentant prayer of wanting to turn from those sins and ask His forgiveness. And that's what repentance means. And if we truly repented from our sins and asked forgiveness, we'd want Him to cleanse us from those sins too. Because see, that's why we will be turning to Him, asking Him about it. When we become a child of God or son of God, as Galatians 4:6 and 7 says, and because you're sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Wherefore thou art no more a servant, but a son. If a son, then an heir of God through Christ. Now, Abba, Father means Daddy, Father. We become joint heirs with Jesus. Joint heirs to Jesus and all of God's promises. When we accept God's living words, Christ, that we're a sinner, and we ask forgiveness of our sins and then respond by calling out to Jesus for salvation, Jesus responds by sending His living word Christ into our hearts to create our new hearts. And then Christ continues to live in our new heart He creates in us. We are then born in the family of God as God's children. As Jesus said in John 3:7, ye must be born again. You know, there's no way to get around it. To be pleasing with God, we must accept and obey His Word. And His Word says we must be born again. We must come to Him and ask forgiveness of our sins for cleansing. And Romans 10:13 says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And that name is Jesus, the only name given among men that we might be saved. Now, I would like to invite you to pray along with me right now and receive Christ into your heart if you're listening. And without, it's just a simple, honest prayer of repenting, that is wanting to turn from your sins, desiring to turn from your sins, trusting and giving your life to Jesus, and inviting Christ Jesus' Spirit, the Spirit of Christ, the living Word, to come into your heart and live. Now, if you'll pray with me, say, Jesus, I ask you to please forgive me and cleanse me of all my sins. I want to turn from my sins. I surrender my heart and my life to you and invite your Spirit, Christ, to create in me the new clean heart and live in my heart. In your name, Jesus, I ask, amen. With an honest prayer, Christ will come to live in your heart. He's in your heart now if you prayed along with me. And if you prayed along with me, I'd appreciate it if you'd send me an email to just let me know. The email is richard@rahardin.com. So now the well, I invite you back to listen to my, go to my website again.
God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin can now be heard on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday mornings at 7 a.m. Central, 8 Eastern, and on Sunday mornings at his regular time, 6 Central, 7 Eastern. Join with him and let's turn our country back to God. It only takes a spark to start a forest fire. Let's get on fire for the Lord. Right here on K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network. Tornado season has once again arrived in the Southern Plains. Moore, Oklahoma, a suburb of Oklahoma City, has seen its share of Mother Nature's power. Southgate Elementary School in Moore suffered heavy damage after severe weather hit the area.
Debris everywhere, a roof destroyed, and a community left once again picking up the pieces. Southgate Elementary took a direct hit in Wednesday night's tornado.
About 10 classrooms at Southgate Elementary and Moore have either structural or water damage. Citizens can help the rebuilding process by donating to Southgate teachers as they work to request the items they need to rebuild their classrooms. Please help by going to donorschoice.org. This organization helped raise $600,000 for the Moore community after the May 2013 tornado. Also, contact your local Red Cross chapter. This has been a public service announcement from your friends at K98Talk.com and the Spark Radio Network. Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books. The leader in talk radio on the internet, right here on K98Talk.com.
Good day and God bless you.